Hello, Inchams. Welcome to the new academic year. How do you do? Oh, now you are the top class of your school. Exciting, isn't it? Oh, hold on. See, your juniors will be observing you. You have lot of responsibility on your shoulders. You have to maintain a better attitude and you must be an inspiration to everyone. Attitude. I used the term attitude, do you remember? We'll discuss about it soon. Before that, let's have a glance on objectives of this session. Objectives. This session helps you to understand the term personality, the term attitude, and you come to know that attitude is an altitude of a person. And you'll come to know the secret of success too. As an oral discourse of this session, you know the features of speech. Right, children. So, we were talking about attitude. This attitude. Before going to know about attitude, you just observe the images what I like to show you. You watch the images and then try to name those persons. I know you can simply identify them. And you can answer them easily. Here is the first person. Observe a smiling man with a white cap on his head. Yeah, with his family, wife. He is very well known to you, taking salute from the army. Now, here comes the second person. Very familiar to you. A perfect captain too. A simple man. I know you can answer easily. And a perfect leader. Right. You have observed the images of two persons. I know you can simply answer. Didn't you? Yeah, you are answering there. I know. Yeah, teacher might be appreciating you. Now, let me show you the persons on screen. Let's see them on the screen. The first is Lal Bahadur Shastri. And the second, APJ Abdul Kalam. How do you know them, children? Are they your friends? Are they our relatives? Are nearby people? It's not so. They are achievers. Lal Bahadur Shastri is a second Prime Minister of Independent India and APJ Abdul Kalam, a great scientist. So, not only that, they are successful persons in the society and an inspiration to everyone. So, they are well known to us, right? So, to be success, we must know their life history. We'll come to see a part of their life history, shall we? At first, we'll know about Lal Bahadur Shastri, right? Lal Bahadur Shastri, you know, he was born on 2nd October in 1904 at Mughalsarai near Kasi. And he is the son of Mr. Sharada Prasad and Mrs. Ram Dulari Devi. He got his inter-college education from East Central Railway Inter-College in the Mughalsarai, that is in Varanasi. He got graduated from Kasi Vidya Peet in Varanasi in 1926. He was awarded Shastri and he was a Bharat Ratna receiver too. Now, we'll come to see his life incidents. His father was a teacher and he also worked as a revenue department employee, but he lived a simple life. His father died when he was only 1.5 years. He had this relation with his father. So, he was brought up by his maternal grandfather and got educated there. He led a poor and penniless life. During childhood, that is during school days, everyone enjoys a lot. Similarly, Shastri one day on the way to home from his school, he went to an orchard with his friends, and the children likes to play and pluck fruits in the garden, isn't it? Similarly, they climbed. All the boys climbed the mango trees in order to pluck the mangoes, but he was standing below the tree. You know what the Shastri did? Did he pluck the fruits? He did not pluck the fruits. But the gardener who reached there punished him. And all the boys ran away from there. And he stood stubborn. And the gardener got hold of him and told that as he was an orphan, it was most important for him to learn much better manners. That incident impressed him deeply, and he decided to behave better in his future, never to commit a mistake. As a boy, Shastri would swim across Ganges twice a day with his books tied on top of his head. Will you do that? No, we won't. Why he did that? Because he did not have enough money to take a ferry to school. Therefore, Shastri has been a successful man in his life. And he led a great achiever. Now, Shastriji gave a message to the people that be honest and hardworking. Never hanker after money. Okay, so now you have come to know about Shastri. Now, we'll see about the other person. That is APJ Abdul Kalam. Let's see about Kalam. Abdul Kalam. Well-known person to us. His full name is Aul Pakir Jainulabuddin Abdul Kalam, and he was born on 15th October 1931. Jainulabuddin Marayakar and Ashiyamma are his parents. He had his primary schooling at Samyar School in Rameshwaram. Then he went to Swat School in Ramnathapuram to have his higher education. Finally, he has become a great scientist and a successful man in the society. He is our 11th president, and people lovely call him as People's President, and he is titled as Missile Man. Okay, so did he born with a silver spoon? No, he led a hard life. He came from a family whose financial conditions weren't sound enough. So what he did? He distributed newspapers to help his father in providing for the family. And he grew up in poverty. You know, children, there used to be no electricity in his house. Today we can't stay a 5 minutes without power supply. And he used to sit under the street lights to continue his education. And he took up odd jobs in his childhood. But he never gave up on his education. He went on working, went on struggling. And finally, he became a role model to us. What made him a role model? He became a role model just because of his achievement? Not so. He has become a role model not through his fight and success against adversity, but also with his humble and simple way of living. Such a simple man he is. And here is an example for his simplicity. You know, when there is a gathering and standing on the dais and giving a speech or message to the audience, suddenly there was a power cut. So what we'll do? We'll stop the speech. But what he did, you see? Once while speaking to around 400 students, Kalam simply ensured the power cut didn't cause any interruption. How? What he did? He walked right in the middle of the crowd and asked the students to surround him. Then he spoke to them with his bare voice and delivered an inspiring speech and made them happy without disappointing. That's the thing, children. They have become popular personalities. What made them popular personalities? Their attitude and their simplicity and their struggle, hard work for success. There are many people like Mahatma Gandhi, Nehru, Swami Vivekananda, Sundar Pichai and many more who has achieved a lot in their life. This is not so easy to achieve all these things, isn't it? What makes them to achieve it? Personality and building this personality is very important. Personality development is very important. Yeah, you got the point. We are going to discuss about personality development, the first unit of our text, the theme personality development. So, what is this personality development? Shall we see? When I question personality, what raises in your mind? Personality, right? When I say personality, what comes to your mind, children? Does personality mean famous people like Gandhi, Mother Teresa, P.V. Narasimha Rao and many more whom you see on the screen and the others off the screen? No, it's not like that. Personality means it's a combination of your thoughts, action and behavior. What you think, how you process it and how you present it. Personality is a character or behavior of a person in different scenarios, that is at different places, different times how you behave. As a development, personality development. What is development? What comes to your mind when I say development? Yeah. Development. Does development mean only physical growth, that is increase in size and shape? It's not so, children. It is an ongoing process of a physical as well as mental growth. So, it's in a combination of knowledge, skills and attitude together. This personality development is a combination of knowledge, skills and attitude. You have come to know what is personality and development. Now, we have to build our personality. How you are going to build up a personality? What are required? How it comes up? See, as a child is born or you come onto this earth, you will observe many things on in your surroundings. So, all those observations are taken into your mind as an impressions. You get some impressions in your mind, that is input. And this input goes under a process and forms thoughts in your mind. That I mean to say, we frame some thoughts and all these thoughts comes out in the form of action, that is output. If this action is placed in a proper manner, your personality will be in a full framed structure. Okay, we want to build a good personality. Now, what makes good personality? What are the qualities you require to make a good personality? Here we see. First, you must be self-confident. I can do. I will be like this. That is required. And you must maintain positive thinking always. Most of us may not have money to go on and fulfill our desires or achieve something or something. So, we should not depress. Be an optimist. Don't be pessimist and don't think that you can't do. Be in a positive thinking. Next, we'll commit lot of mistakes and we think that we did a mistake. No need to be bothered. Learn from our mistakes. We must learn from our mistakes. Out of this, trust your own efforts and abilities. We should not think that I can't do this. Think I can do this and we must go on. And finally, you can do, but do that service with selflessness. Give a selfless service to people who ever require, maybe yourself or to the society. Right, you learned how you can make a good personality, but you have to develop a good personality. You have a desire to develop a good personality. What are the qualities or what the process you require to develop a good personality? That you just come to know from this. Let's see. to develop a good personality, what you should do is you set a goal. Goal setting is must. It may be a short term goal or long term goal. Fix a goal and fight for it. Fixing a goal is not enough. Proper time management is required. Time management in sense, I'll work from 9 to 9 and I'll achieve it. It's not so, children. You have to take right decision at right time and implement it. Make it an action. You may face many hurdles on the way, but should not give up. Never give up. This is required. And yeah, you have many thoughts in your mind. You want to do this, you want to do that, you want to achieve this, but that has to come out from you and placed in an action. For that, you need communicative skills. Communicative skills in sense, what you speak, there must be a clarity. You must express your thoughts clearly with a confidence, then you can achieve it. Top of all these, leadership qualities. I'm not a leader, I'm a common man, what I can do? All these are trash, children. Every human being is a leader. Every person will have a leadership qualities. Remember that. How you can use it? Taking regular actions. What you do, do it regularly. Practice it regularly. And learn from failures. Learn from failures. Fail itself defined as first attempt in learning. It's a first attempt in learning. So when we maintain these qualities, we can gain good personality. So here we were talking about personality, right? So at the beginning of the unit, I said attitude, but we were talking about personality. What is this personality and what is this attitude? Are they correlated? Is there any difference? Are they broadly variated? You must have an idea about it. So here you'll come to know about it. Let's see that. Personality is different from attitude. Your thoughts, emotions, and certain characteristics make your personality. Whereas attitude, your behavior or way of response or thinking in a particular situation shows your attitude. In case of personality, your personality remains same all through the life. Attitude keeps on changing. Personality is an outcome of what you learn over years, that is right from birth, childhood, teenage, adolescence, and on and on. Attitude is a result of your experience over a period there and then. I think I made a clear variation of personality and attitude. I tried to give you differentiation of personality and attitude. Is it clear, children? I think you got it. Now you just watch a video, then we'll discuss some more about this attitude and personality. Here is the video. Yeah, have you enjoyed the video, children? It's a nice dance, isn't it? A great dancer. Could you recognize her? Did you find anything wrong with her? What's wrong with her? I know you are answering that to your teacher. Yes, you are right. She is none other than Sudha Chandran, a great dancer. We must know about her. Sudha Chandran. She was born in Kerala. And you know, she is a great dancer right from childhood. Very pity. One day she met with an accident when she was just 16 years. And doctors missed a small wound in her ankle and plastered it when she was taken to hospital. This later got infected and there was no other alternative left but to amputate her leg, and she has become lame. But she was very strong, determined and willpowered. She has overcome her disability by getting a prosthetic Jaipur foot. She worked hard to stand on it. Not only standing children, she started to dance even. Her family, doctor, friends, everyone helped her in this achievement. And she has become one of the most popular classical dancers of the country. And she has performed Bharatanatyam internationally, and today she is inspiration to everyone on this earth. She is a well-known figure in the Indian television and film industry too. She received many awards for her amazing talent and inspiration to many of us. So, what do you say, children? Disability is not an obstacle for achievement. Just one day, if we suffer from headache or fever, we say, "Ma, I don't want to go to school. Today I am suffering from fever." Is it right? If you are strongly willed, you will overcome all the obstacles on your way and fight for your achievement. That's the thing. Now, we have come to know about Sudha Chandran. There are two more famous personalities who are disabled, but who has not let this disability be an obstacle for their achievement. Let's see about them in brief. Yes, this is Arunima Sinha. It's very pity, children. She lost her leg when some robbers pushed her out of a moving train. But just 2 years later, she became the first woman amputee to climb Mount Everest. Mount Everest, children. And the second is Girish Sharma. He lost his leg in a train accident. He was a kid. But this setback in his life did not stop him from becoming a badminton champion. How? Ever since he was a kid, he would take part in outdoor activities with other kids without letting his disability come in the way. What is the secret of their success? Yes, you are right. That is their attitude. Attitude plays a vital role in your life. What is their attitude? You just observe. They look small, but they aim big. Their attitude is, "I can." Self-confident. They always said, "I can, I will, I must, I should." That self-confidence is their attitude. Their willpower, their determination, their dedication, goal setting, time management are their attitude. And they don't complain what they can't change. They didn't complain about what they can't change. They went on with what they have and achieved their goal. They said that the only disability is bad attitude. These all achievers say that, "I am not disabled. If I have bad attitude, it's my disability." But I'm not so. And they always said, "There is nothing like impossible." And they said, "I am possible. I am possible." Repeat, children. You just go on saying, "I am possible." You have to say every day to yourself, "I am possible. I can." It's not "I can't." Arise it. It. T. T. Arise the T and say, "I can." Right, children. Now you have observed a lot of videos and we have talked a lot about attitude and personality. So I think you are on a fire, got boosted to achieve your goal and do something which can lead you to your aim, right? But before that, I want to present a speech to you which was given by Abdul Kalam.
Friends, good evening to all of you. First of all, I would like to say that I am very sorry that I got delayed because I got to be a big young crowd. I could not come out of it. Okay. Two student group, so I am sorry for it. So we will compensate some way. First, I would like to greet Professor Anand, members of the faculty, and dear students, to every one of you, my greetings. On this great day of a beautiful day of thinking about Swami Vivekananda, I am very happy to see young people. I am delighted to be here at the Indian Institute of Technology Madras and address the members of this renowned place of learning and other guests present here. My greeting to you, my friends. Friends, before I begin my address, I would like to share a thought with all the youth present here. I have met so far 11 million youth present, 11 million youth like you in a decade's time from various parts of the country. I have met in India and abroad, I have seen their hopes and experienced their pains, walked with their aspirations and heard through their despair also. All this experience made me to learn something about them, which I would like to share with you. Shall I? I learned, carefully hear me what I'm saying. I learned, what did I learn from the youth of 11 million people? I learned every youth wants to be unique. Every youth wants to be unique. That is you. Every youth wants to be unique, that is you. But the world around you is doing its best day and night to make you just everybody else. Now, the question is whether you want to be you or everybody else. You want to be you?
Yes.
Not everybody else. Now, if the question being like everybody else is convenient at the first glance, but not satisfying in the long vision. The challenge, therefore, my young friends, is that you have to fight the hardest battle. You have to fight the hardest battle which any human being can ever imagine to fight, and never stop fighting until you arrive at your destined place. That is the unique you. To get the unique you is a big battle. The battle means you don't need to take a gun. The battle means you have to have four unique things. Four unique tools you must have in that battle. One is you have to set the goal. The second one is acquire the knowledge continuously. And third one is the hard work with the devotion. And fourth is perseverance.
How was the speech? Have you got inspired? Yeah, I know you are getting ready to go and fight for your life, right? But here it's not the topic, children. We are going to discuss about the features of speech, right? If you have observed the speech, how did he start? With a greeting. He is standing before the audience and is talking directly to the audience, isn't it? It's a direct presentation to the audience. So when you are standing before the audience and presenting to the audience, how you have to do, what the way you have to present yourself, that we must bear in our mind, and then we can make our speech right and proper way. Features of the speech, as you are addressing directly, your volume, voice should be audible. It should be audible. And there must be an intonation. You should not leave the stress accent of your language out the words. Facial expressions plays a vital role. And moreover, gestures and body movement is required a lot. Rhetorical questions are required. And he has used youth, unique, certain words repeatedly. A repetition is required. Some words are the heart of the speech. Certain words we call as lists of three. You have to repeat those words thrice, like education, education, education. Must use emotional language. He used many certain words. And you know, direct addressing is very important. And as you are addressing directly, evidences are very important. Now, it's your turn to stand before your friends and give a fabulous speech, an inspiring speech to your friends. Right, you got the point. It is assignment time. Take your assignment and get ready for the next 20 minutes part. Assignment. Prepare a speech on personality of any successful person's success and present it to your class. Now we have come to end of the session. Hard work, dedication and commitment, determination, willpower. Sounds hard, I mean weight, but they are just like wheels of our life. Just put your shoulders onto the wheels and go on working. If you work hard, you will achieve your aim. Nothing is like an obstacle if you have strong willpower for your achievement. Bye bye children. We'll meet again in the next session. Good luck.
Hello children, how are you? I hope all of you are fine. Welcome back to the digital class. Have you ever visited Vemulawada or Yadadri or Bijgi Sharif? Oh, what is this action of visit called? Is it a pilgrimage? Or is it a travel? Or is it a trip? Or is it an excursion? What is this? Okay. Let's try to find the differences among these terms now. Pilgrimage, a visit to a place that is considered special, where you go to show your respect, particularly religious. For example, every year we go to Vemulawada on a pilgrimage. Travel, to move or go from one place to another, usually over a long distance. For example, I travel to work by train. Trip, a movement in which you go somewhere, usually for a short time, and come back again. For example, we are going on a trip to Anantagiri Hills this Sunday. Journey, the act of traveling from one place to another, especially in a vehicle. For example, we are going on a long journey to the Andaman. Excursion. An excursion is a trip or visit to an interesting place. For example, we are going on an excursion to Hyderabad city this week. Okay, children, I think now you have understood the differences among these terms. Journey, travel, trip, excursion, etc. Now, let's say watch a video here. Okay, children, have you watched the video? Right. Then what's about this video? Is it a trip or a journey or a travel? What are the places you have watched in the video? and what were the travelers or the passengers doing in that video. Okay, shall we discuss it? It's about a small trip. The place is Ooty, and the mode of the journey is train, and the travelers are enjoying by watching the scenery of the place. Okay, today we are going to discuss our class 10 lesson, The Journey, under the theme Human Relations. After going through this lesson, you will be able to know about the author of the lesson, understand the human relations, understand and comprehend the text, and construct a simple discourse conversation. The present story, The Journey, is written by Yashi Dorji Tongochi, an Assamese and English writer. This is Yashi Dorji Tongochi, the author of our present lesson. He was born on 13th June 1952 at Jigan village of West Kameng district of Arunachal Pradesh. He belongs to Sherdukpen tribe of Arunachal Pradesh, the land of rising sun. His mother tongue was Sherdukpen, a dialect spoken by a few thousand people in the state. So he was studied in Assamese and started his literary career in Assamese language. His writings deal with the cultural life of the Mompa and Sherdukpen tribes of Arunachal Pradesh. In 1977, he was appointed as Arunachal Pradesh Civil Services Officer. Tongochi was inducted to Indian Administrative Service, that is IAS, in 1992. He received many prestigious awards like Sahitya Akademi Award in 2005, Poolchand Khandelwal Singhati Bata Award in 2001, the Bhasha Bharati Award from Central Institute of Indian Languages, CIL, located in Mysore, in 2005, Vasudeva Jalan Award from Assam Sahitya Sabha, and Bhupen Hazarika Award from Sharhad, a Pune-based NGO, in 2017. Children, we shall discuss the story now. The title of the story is The Journey. Here the journey means multiple meanings are there. Here the journey means it might be a small part of writer's life, or it might be the journey from writer's village to some other area, or it might be bitter or sweet experiences of the writer, or it might be a collection of personal experiences, or it might be opinions and ideas of the writer of a particular period of his life. The entire story goes in the first person narration. The narrator or the writer was a government official. He came to his village, a remote tribal area in Arunachal Pradesh state. There was a special purpose of coming to the village this time. His parents had arranged marriage for the writer, according to the customs of their tribal society. After spending 6 months in the village, the narrator did not like to go back to his job, as he had to leave behind his newly wedded wife in the village. He wanted to extend his leave, even taking unpaid leave. But during the vacation, his responsibilities were increased and he had got into debt. So after some dilly-dallying, he finally decided to go back to his job in the city. The narrator's area was a hilly terrain without any more tribal roads. The narrator did not have much luggage, just a trunk. While coming to his village, the narrator engaged a porter to carry his trunk from the nearest bus stop, that is Dirang. This time also, the narrator wanted to engage a porter to carry his trunk box to the bus stop. But there were no porters in his village. Usually, at another time, he would find easily someone to carry his luggage to Dirang. There was no one to help him in carrying his trunk to the bus stop, as it was the season of harvesting and most of the villagers were busy in their fields. Moreover, nobody had time to spare for him. In fact, carrying the trunk should not have been such a worry for him. But his education had made him shun physical labor. He thought that he was a government officer and carrying his own luggage would degrade him and his position. Otherwise, carrying a chest of 20 kilo on the back was not at all an issue to the narrator like young man. The narrator tried in different ways to find someone who could carry his luggage to the bus stop.
Father, I want to go. Where? I want to my job.
Okay, my son. Okay, children. Now let's watch a small video here.
Please carry this bag. Please help me.
Finally, his father came up with a solution. His father said that he would carry the luggage for the narrator, that is, his sons. The narrator protested and did not allow his father to carry the luggage. How could a son allow his old father to carry his own luggage? What would people think about the young man? What would they say? Can we see such scenes in our daily life? Does any son who is young and active allow his father to carry the luggage? The narrator tried to discourage his father in doing such activity, but he failed. Finally, his father decided to carry the luggage of the narrator to the bus stop, Dirang. On the day of leave, a large crowd gathered at the narrator's place to see him off. People came to wish him and luck. It was 10:20 a.m. when the narrator left for Dirang. His father had already left and the narrator was trying to catch him up. Please watch this video, children.
I'm going. Bye.
The narrator was walking very fast to catch up his father. 3 kilometers down the hilly road, the narrator caught up his father. By the time, the narrator was tired and gasping. The narrator's father looked at him and asked if he would like to take some rest. Okay, children, now watch this video again. Quickly, the narrator sat on a rock as he crossed 2 hills on the way up to the spot. His father laughed at the narrator's action. Father was quiet for some time. He thoughtfully looked at the son for a moment and drank some homemade wine. The father was carrying a trunk of 20 kilos on his back behind the narrator, and the narrator was walking with a tiny bag in his hand. They were walking up a narrow hilly road like two dumb people. They were not talking to each other. The narrator started introspection. The narrator was feeling guilty for making his father carrying the luggage. The narrator tried to tell his father that he would carry his own luggage, but his guilt and shame did not allow him to do so. That self-consciousness had probably to do with his education, the white-collar job that he had, or quite simply his pride. He had the feeling that if he had carried the luggage, his father, his people, in fact, the whole world would laugh at him and he would be belittled. The narrator's father had provided the narrator education, so as the narrator was able to realize his dreams. His parents were truly proud of him. All the villagers showing respect towards the narrator and his parents because of his education and job. His father did not allow the narrator in carrying the luggage because of this reason. The narrator stayed in hostels during his education, so he had no experience of physical labor. Though the narrator was young, he was physically useless. He continued his walking silently with his father. On the way, they stayed at two more places and had their tiffin, but they hardly talked. Finally, they reached Dirang. The bus from Tawang to Dirang had not reached. So the narrator and his father entered a tea shop and sat facing each other. His father appeared tired. The waiter served two cups of tea. Then father asked if the narrator had a pair of old shoes. The narrator asked why. His father told that the road was uneven with full of pebbles and it would hurt while walking. The narrator looked at the feet of his father. They were bare and had some cracks. The narrator noticed it first time. The narrator did not find any difficulty while coming from his village to Dirang because he wore hunting boots. But his father did not have any shoe. Immediately, the narrator checked his money purse. He found rupees 40. He thought a pair of canvas shoe would cost around rupees 12, and the remaining amount would be enough for him to go to Bomdila. But his father protested and said not to spend money on shoe. He asked for only old pair of shoes. The narrator tried to convince his father. His father did not agree. Reluctantly, the narrator gave him the hunting boots. Then he took old pair of leather shoes from trunk and wore them. He looked at the father. His father was happy with the shoes and satisfied. Suddenly, his father said to take care of him. His father wanted to say something, but the bus had started. The narrator saw his father gradually receding into the distance. He saw the road they had come. It appeared like a giant motionless rope. Father would use the same road to go to back home. Simultaneously, their journey started in two opposite directions, with the narrator seated in the luxurious seat of a bus and his father walking back with their weary legs on the pebble strewn road. Children, now you have listened to the story. Okay? Now it's time for assignment. Please answer these questions. Why did the narrator get into debt? The author feared that the whole world would laugh at him if he carried the trunk. Was the fear imaginary or real? Give reasons for your answer. Was the narrator really unable to carry his own luggage? Why did his father help him? Give reasons. Discuss answers with your friends and present them in the class. Okay, children. After this, it's time for discourse. Now, we shall discuss a small discourse, conversation. But before that, we discuss what are the differences between a dialogue and a conversation. Please watch it. Dialogue, conversation. Dialogue is between two persons. Dialogue is for purpose. Whereas conversation is talking between two or more persons. Most part of the dialogue includes questions and answers, requests and information. Whereas conversation means it is interactive, more or less spontaneous communication between two or more conversants. The word dialogue is used in the sense of discussion, but the conversation is used in the sense of talking. Dialogue responses depending on the user, utterance and information within it. In talking, one can say everything. One can joke. One can tell a story, or one can laugh. A dialogue sounds like a more formal or serious discussion, but conversation, mostly informal language is used. Dialogue, people freely and creatively explore issues, listen deeply to each other, but conversation is informal interchange of thoughts, information, etc. By spoken words, oral communication between persons, talk or colloquy. Children, now let's say watch a video on a small conversation. Please watch it.
Bob, can you help me with something?
Sure.
I'm trying to print a file, but the printer won't work.
Push the green button on the printer.
Why?
To turn it on. It won't print unless it's on.
Oh, right. Silly me. Thank you.
Hey, Bob. My laptop crashed and I can't get it to do anything. I type on the keyboard and nothing happens.
Stick this here.
Why?
To restart the computer.
You sure? Okay, thanks.
Bob, I could use a hand with something.
What is it?
Somebody sent me an email, but I think it has a virus in it.
Don't open the attachment. Click on the no virus icon on the toolbar.
Why?
To clean the computer and stop the virus.
Thanks. Bob, can I ask you another question?
I'm sorry, but I can't get any work done with all these questions. Please, I have some very important stuff I need to finish right now.
Game over. Game over.
Very important stuff.
Game over. Game over.
Children, have you watched the video? Okay. Now, basing on this video, we shall come to conclusion of various features of a conversation. Okay? Features of a conversation. The student is expected to write a conversation containing dialogues with a number of exchanges ranging from 10 to 12. The exchanges should be in a sequential order. It can be sustained sufficiently long by adding useful exchanges and ideas. It should not be ended abruptly. Also includes involving or inviting others into the conversation. Generally, contains expressions and features depicting social norms. Discourse markers of a conversation like well, preciously, anyway, I mean, you know, oh, then, actually, as a matter of fact, to be frank, okay, etc., add a natural look to the conversation. Short responses, question tags, and contractions, that is, we would or we had, must not, I'll, etc., are also the features of a natural conversation. The exchanges in a conversation are linked with each other using suitable cohesive devices like but, now, somehow, anyhow, I suppose, etc., show agreement and disagreement. Care should be taken that the sentences used should have proper syntax or word form such as tense, PNG, agreements, affixes, etc. The conventions of writing, that is, punctuation marks and spelling, are also important. Children, Have you observed the different features of a conversation? Right. Now we discuss the assessment indicators of conversation. Assessment indicators of a conversation. Writing dialogue with 5 to 10 exchanges. Using proper sequence of exchanges. Sustaining the conversation with social norms. Using discourse markers. Using short responses and tags wherever necessary. Using dialogues apt to the context. Using appropriate cohesive devices. Using well-formed constructions. Maintaining conventions of writing, spelling. Using proper punctuations. All indicators except one carry 1 mark each. Indicator 1 carries 2 marks. Children, now you have observed the features and assessment indicators of conversation. Now it's time for assignment. Please do this assignment in the classroom. In the lesson, The Journey, the narrator and his father were walking through the hilly terrain. They were silent for most of the time during their journey. Now suppose the author and his father were talking freely and exchanging their ideas. Write a possible conversation between the narrator and his father. Okay, children, I think you have enjoyed the lesson. We shall meet again in the next class. Bye.